1948. As the world recovered from World War II, the United Nations created the World Health Organization, a global health agency to help countries promote health, prevent disease, and save lives. Each year in May, 194 member countries participate in the World Health Assembly to discuss global health policies and decide on recommendations for governments. WHO recognizes that good health is shaped by a combination of social, economic, and environmental factors. The socio-ecological determinants of health must be taken into account when identifying what needs to be done to promote health and prevent disease. But each country has its own interests and views on how to keep its people healthy. Each member country, however, only has one vote when deciding on WHO priorities and shaping global health policy. The decision-making process starts long before the vote. And the largest and wealthiest countries are in a better position to influence the discussions in the Assembly. This balance of power depends on delegation members, economic leverage, political pressure, and most importantly, financial support. Each state pays assessed contribution based on its national income to cover WHO core budget. Assessed contribution accounts for less than 20% of the WHO funding and have declined over the years. Payments from member states have sometimes been delayed. The balance to cover WHO's financial needs is raised through voluntary contributions from countries or private donors. Voluntary contributions have accounted for more than three-quarters of WHO funding in recent years. In addition to voluntary contributions from member states, WHO increasingly relies on private donations from corporations and philanthropic donors like the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, which is becoming one of WHO's largest private donors. The private donors are gaining significant political influence within WHO. This allows them to set the agenda, more so than the actual member states. As with other UN agencies, private interests are hampering WHO's efforts and influencing the global health agenda. For example, WHO is currently working to prevent the hoarding of vaccines and medicines, like we saw in the early days of COVID. At the same time, it is receiving more and more funding from pharmaceutical companies that are profiting from these cold market practices. With the likelihood of new pandemics and increasing health inequalities, we must not allow corporate interests to undermine WHO's ability to champion health and treat disease. We must advocate for member states to take responsibility for safeguarding public health institutions such as the WHO and enable the WHO to fulfill its mandate. Health for all. Will you join us?